Good evening, everyone. Thank you for joining us. Welcome to this evening's Cold Lake Teachers Program, the Global Classroom, Creating Universal Citizens. My name is Rachel Mizuno. I serve as the Director of Next Generation here at the Council and help to engage educator voices, youth voices, and young professional voices here at the Council. Before we start, I just have a few housekeeping remarks. Today's event is on the record and is being live streamed. We always welcome social media engagement, but please silence your phones. The Council is an independent, nonpartisan platform, and views expressed by the individuals we host are their own and do not necessarily represent institutional positions or views of the Council. Thank you to the members of our audience today. Your support is crucial to our work, and if you're not a member, please consider joining the Council. Later, I will jump back on stage to take audience questions from the room, and also we have questions online, so you can see the link should be appearing on the screens, but the link you can go to is CHICNFIO for all of you who are watching the live stream. I will also, at the end of our program, announce our newest cohort of Cold Lake Global Teachers at the Council. It's now my pleasure to introduce Council President Ivo Dalder for a few comments.
Well, good evening. It's wonderful always to be here and to celebrate youth, education, the future. But I want to spend a moment or two to talk about a person who helped make this possible. You will shortly hear from Mike Koldyke, but Pat Koldyke, who was a board member at the Chicago Council, a long, long time supporter of the Chicago Council, was truly an innovative spirit behind not only the Koldyke Teacher Program, but about so much else that has to do with education. Pat passed away earlier this year, and we miss her dearly. But we remember her in everything that she brought to the Council. She also remember her as a really, truly extraordinary person. And the way that I talk about it, Pat was a mensch, a true mensch. She helped people. She helped people in all the kinds of different ways to make sure that they would benefit to the greatest possible extent from what was happening around the world. As I said, she cared about kids, she cared about teachers, she cared about quality education, and she was an unbelievably wonderful woman. I had the privilege of getting to know Pat and Mike quite well. Early on, when I came here to the Council back in 2013, I did a trip to the ranch that they have in Santa Fe, New Mexico, and with Pat Koldyke, who in that time was already advanced in age, we ascended horses, in the case of my two sons and my wife for the first time, and drove out into the canyon right behind Pat and saw the cattle and saw what it was like to live in the West. And there you saw what Pat Koldyke was, a true person who loved life to the fullest extent, lived it to the fullest extent, and then always gave back to her community, including her beloved Chicago. And we're very glad, the Chicago Council on Global Affairs. So this program is in honor of her memory. As indeed is the entire Koldyke program that we continue to have, and we're so blessed to have had Pat with us for so very long, and we're very blessed to have still with us Mike Koldyke. So with that, I'm going to hand over the microphone to Mike.
Hey, good evening. And thank you, Ivo. For those of you who may be new to the Council, just a word about Ivo Dalder. He's a treasure of Chicago. That's a great word, mensch, and I love it for Pat, because she was that. And this man as I mentioned, we're really fortunate to have him here. It's my pleasure to be involved with the council and supporting the Coldock Initiative and now the Global Teachers Program. Pat and I established the Coldock Global Teachers Program in 2016 with the aim of investing and nurturing the professional development of Chicago area high school teachers. For the third year, the Coldock Global Teachers Program has sent a group of Chicago teachers around the world to deepen their knowledge of global education models and bring cross-cultural experiences back to their classrooms. Now you think on that. I'm a teacher at XYZ High School. I care deeply about my kids, and I've really probably never, I've been to Wisconsin, I may have been to Indiana, but I haven't been to Helsinki or Cairo, and I'm dying to go, because what I hear about some of the things that they're doing in those schools, in the German schools and other places, is really quite noteworthy. So it was Pat's idea. Let's make it possible. Let's see if the council's interested. Ivo snapped it up. And his people have worked unsparingly to make it a great success. And so each year, how many now do we do? Four or five? Five, okay. Extraordinary teachers are selected, and they're told they could go anywhere in the world. And what they're to do is to bring back ideas and caring about what they've seen, who they've met, and what they might be able to extract to their classrooms. We're proud of the program, and the council's given it life and given it a thrilling beginning. What else did I say here? We know that equity and access to high-quality educational opportunities are critical for every student across all schools and neighborhoods. And one way to achieve equity and quality in the classrooms is by providing students with access to global programs. I'd now like to welcome our panel. First of all, one of our Coldock Global teachers, right here, Carrie Balnick. I guess they have you're probably the only Carrie up here, so it's not a problem. Carrie's a history teacher, a baseball coach, and a 16-inch softball coach at Farragut Career Academy. In 2018, he traveled to Cuba, Mexico, and Puerto Rico to study immigration and historical memory as part of the Coldock Teacher Program. And he now holds a bilingual endorsement in Spanish in addition to his Russian endorsement. We look forward to hearing from Carrie and how he has incorporated his findings and cross-cultural experiences back to the classroom. Cindy Lowe. She just graduated. She says currently. Formerly a high school senior at Naperville Central High School. She's an Illinois Global Scholar, a certificate awarded to students who demonstrate global competence. In the near future, she will be attending Vanderbilt University for a double major in economics and public policy. And Ivo said, let's see how long that double major, might be a triple major before she's finished. Heather Singmaster. Director of the Global Cities Education Network and Career Technical Education at the Asia Society, where she focuses on international benchmarking and integrating global career readiness skills into career technical education programs, as well as state and national policy. She also leads the Global Cities Education Network, an international network of cities focused on best practice sharing in education. Our moderator tonight is Abigail Joseph. She's the chief of staff to the Board of Education in the city of Chicago. In her position, she leverages over a decade of experience as a senior leader at the Chicago public schools to advise on strategy, policy, and operational priorities. Abigail is also a member of the 2016 Class of Emerging Leaders, a global policy and leadership development experience here at the Council, now celebrating its 10th year. I had lunch today with the head of WTTW, Channel 11 Public Television. I said, you know, one thing that you people might look into very carefully, which is it's a little known fact, the evolution and the strength and the great success of the Chicago public schools. It's really quite surprising how little we know about what's transpired in the last 10 years. What Janice Jackson has done and what others have done and what you're doing there now, Abigail. It's really quite extraordinary. I said, you know, you're the head of Channel 11. You ought to look into this. Yeah, you really ought to help people understand. There was a study, just one little example. There was a study done at Princeton, at Stanford, another decent university. 70 was great in length, probably cost a lot of money. Stanford did a study of the 200 largest districts in America. And the study had to do with the learning curve and the preparation and the evolution of kids from third grade to eighth grade. Absolutely critical. If you can't read and comprehend and understand and compute in eighth grade, high school may be just a distant memory. There were 200 of the largest districts, 200 of the largest districts in America that took part in the study under Dr. Reardon's competent staff at Stanford. Guess who finished first out of 200 large school districts? Do you know? No, you don't know, do you? Chicago. It's one of the least little known or nor appreciated facts in all. And that's just part of it. So it's high time that we all learn more about it, because it's really quite an extraordinary business. So here's the panel. Here's the panel. We're lucky to have you, and thank you for being here.
Thank you, Mike. Thank you, Evo and Rachel, for making this program happen. We're going to have some fun tonight. Thank you all for being here. It's a beautiful night, but you're here in the conference center to have a conversation about global education and global competency. So we're going to have some fun. We talked in the green room beforehand how we're going to make this a little bit more improvisational. So I have some scripted questions, but you know, as the conversation goes along, if any of my panelists have additional thoughts and comments, please let's just be more freeform. So this evening's panel is going to unpack for us the question of what a globally focused education looks like from the perspective of a student, a teacher, and a policymaker. We're going to further explore the impact. Yes, that's right. Yes, I hear enthusiasm in the back from our smallest participant. We're going to further explore the impact it has on students and the tools, resources, and partnerships needed to make it all happen. In education, we have a lot of discussion about what it means to be a student in an age of increased connectivity and cross-culturally engaged with 21st century skills. We've all heard the buzzwords, global education, global competence. The title of this panel is The Global Classroom, Creating Universal Citizens. But what are we really talking about, and towards what end? Is the work of a global education about job prospects? Is it about a discrete skill set that is going to take a student to and through college and career? Or is it something a little bit more complex, like a cosmopolitan mindset, a lens or perspective or disposition to help address society's trickiest challenges? Is it about equity, excellence? As our panel explores why a global education is important, we will consider together how it can also be the great equalizer for the many disparities we find within education. And what better way to have a rich and meaningful discussion than to ground the conversation in student voice? So this one's for you, Cindy. You're one of the first students in Illinois to graduate this spring as an Illinois Global Scholar. Can you tell us what that means and how your school is integrating global citizenship?
So this year I had the privilege of being part of the Global Scholar Program. And then so our program consists of having 8 credits in globally focused education courses, global collaboration, and also service learning throughout the year. So specifically for our program, we have to focus on the perspectives of students that we're trying to understand. And so we also have a capstone course that we must finish throughout the semester, focusing on discovering a topic or issue and searching for a way to solve it. And so for global education within my high school, we usually focus with the humanities courses, so including global perspectives throughout the coursework throughout the school year, such as learning about different cultures or talking to people from around the world.
So tell us a little bit about your capstone project, because it was an incredibly rigorous experience that you went through. And I think as you describe your capstone project, it will become clear about just the complexity of the kinds of problems that you were asked to solve.
Mm-hmm. So my capstone course was focused on investigating the Syrian conflict and also how to better humanitarian aid for internally displaced people in Syria. So throughout the semester, the capstone course involves creating a narrative, so documenting every single one of your experiences throughout the semester, as well as the global collaboration aspect of getting into contact with experts around the world. So my capstone eventually ended up into a 60-page narrative and an 8-page proposal for NGOs to better humanitarian aid.
And what would you say, because we talked a little bit about this before, and I thought it was really interesting when you were describing just some of the challenges,
right.
But I think by describing some of the challenges for you, it will become clear just how rigorous the work really was.
Right, so one of the biggest challenges of Capstone was getting into contact with experts around the world. So for the global collaboration aspect, as I said before, you have to contact experts and specialists and interview them and continue talking to them throughout the semester. So one of the biggest challenges was actually getting into contact with those experts. So maintaining contact and also convincing those experts to actually keep in contact with you, since a lot of specialists don't really think that a high school student has the potential to actually make an impact on the world.
Isn't that amazing? Is there anybody else in the audience, just by show of hands, that had that kind of project in high school? Because I went to a great high school. I see one. You had it up and then you had it down. Yes, Wisconsin was one of the first states. Well, this is a good segue to Heather, who has really seen this work, you know, across our nation and across the world, really. So tell us a little bit about the kinds of things that you've seen in global education that are happening.
Sure, yeah. So I work at the Center for Global Education at Asia Society, and we defined global competence a few years ago with stakeholders from across the country. And it's the definition that's been adopted by the US Department of Education, by OECD, and UNESCO. And so we really believe that students should be able to be globally competent in 4 domains. So first, have the ability to investigate the world, so be interested in the world and how it works. Second, to recognize perspectives, so recognize that they have a perspective and you may or may not share it, but look at both sides and from that create a new point of view. The third is to be effective communicators, especially with diverse audiences, and be able to use technology. And then last is take action. So really apply what they've learned to make a difference locally or globally. And so I think that programs like Cindy's, like the Illinois Global Scholar Program, really take into account all of these aspects of global competence, because it's the academic piece, the social emotional learning, but then also there's that take action piece where you're out there making a difference in the world and having an impact. And so we run a network of small schools across the country. There are full models of what it means to be a global school, where global content is integrated throughout the schools. And what we see in our schools, which are mostly in low-income urban areas, our students are much more engaged in their education and they see the relevance. And so we have about a 90% graduation rate in those schools. But so there are networks like this, there are state programs that are happening across the country that are really spreading. But then there's also just districts and teachers who are doing this on their own, because you don't have to be part of a formal program. Really, we say this can be integrated into any classroom. So there are lots of tools and resources out there that can help you, even if you're an individual teacher in the classroom.
So often we hear from schools that there's not enough time to add something like this to the already very busy schedule. So what do you say to schools or cities or states that might have a little bit of pushback that, you know, okay, global education is great, whatever that means, but, you know, we've got literacy and we've got math and we've got other things that we're trying to do.
Right. Yeah, that's why we say it can be really integrated. So bring in those topics into your math class, you know, make it applied. And especially through the project-based learning, that's our model is all high-quality project-based learning, where students are applying what they're learning and thinking about, you know, using the math or the science to make a difference, and combining that with the literacy classes that they're already learning. So, and thinking about, you know, we always say too is to take a local issue first and then tie that to a global issue. So we do a lot of work with the UN Sustainable Development Goals, which are a set of goals that the UN unanimously agreed upon in 2015, and basically they aim to eradicate poverty to be a sustainable world by 2030. So basically any local issue you have, you can take one of the goals and tie it to that issue and see what's happening around the world. And there's tons of resources for almost any curricular area that are tied to those goals. They have a website called Teach SDGs, and within there you can just find a ton of lesson plans. So it really fits into whatever curriculum you're already teaching.
So speaking of teaching, Carrie, our teacher on the panel, tell us a little bit about your experience going to Cuba, Mexico, and Puerto Rico, and how this program helped you implement a more globally focused curriculum in your classroom.
I think to talk about all that stuff, I would need more than the time we have on the clock. So I think the most fruitful part of my experience was the time that I spent in Mexico, where I learned about immigration. And so I was there for about 3 weeks, and through the council, through Rachel, she was able to connect me with one of her friends, because she used to work in Tijuana. So I spent like almost a week in a YMCA shelter on the border, and had an opportunity to go to San Diego and meet with the ACLU and learn about some of the things that they're doing to help Dreamers, and met a lot of kids, some migrant youth that were trying to get to the United States, and like lived with them for a week and got to have that experience there. And I also met one of my students and their families in Cuernavaca, which was a great experience to see what their life was like there. I met one of my fellow teachers from Farragut, and her husband actually is in the back, and we met at a restaurant in Mexico City, and I just saw on the board up here that he's selected for next year, so that was a nice surprise. Mm-hmm. And I also went to this place called Las Patronas, which is where women in Mexico for the last now 25 years have been making food, drinks for the people as they ride the train and go across. And so they kind of throw it up to the people. So I spent about a week there getting to know a lot of the migrant youth that were coming across and the women who had been working there. And so that was like a great personal experience for me. But then I was also able to bring some of these things back to my students. And I think my vision going out there was like, all right, I'm going to gather all these primary sources, so I'm going to just, you know, bring back photos and interview people and videos, and I did all that stuff, and I was actually able to like get some diaries that kids had left behind in the shelters, and they weren't anybody's that were there. I asked some of the kids, and so I got to take some photos, and so when I had brought back these to the classroom, the kids loved learning and seeing some of these things. But I think sometimes when you're traveling, the best experiences you have are the ones that you don't expect. And there was a French journalist who was also at Las Patronas when I was, and he was telling me this experience that he had, where he had crisscrossed the border from the U.S. to the Mexico side and was interviewing people on both sides to see their perspective about the immigration debate. And that gave me the idea for my new unit that I did this year to show students like the variety of perspectives, to learn about the political spectrum and liberals and conservatives, Democrats, Republicans, the things that they believe, to learn about media bias and you know, which websites they go to are going to be maybe trying to convince them of something or something different. And I didn't intend or plan like that that was going to be, you know, the what was going to come from this. And I just kind of kept an open mind with it. And I think this unit was really successful.
So let's go a little bit deeper. You had this experience that was amazing, and it really helped to reshape major aspects of your curriculum. How has it shaped you as an educator?
Well, for one, I really improved my Spanish. it's a big deal because I have like 8 kids right now that don't speak English. And so in the past, I haven't been able to communicate with them, and a lot of the parents at my school don't speak English. So, you know, now at report card pickup, I can talk to them. Now, if I have an issue, I can pick up the phone and call them. And I think, like, I show those 8 kids that if I can learn a language, you can, because I make mistakes all the time. And so I'm starting to see like more growth from them as well, because now I know how I can study a language, and then I try and give them some of those tools as well. So I think that's like been a really helpful way. The curriculum I think was really useful, and I just learned a lot about the culture. I feel like it's allowed me to sort of fit in better and earn more respect from the kids that I know different things about Mexico, different places from Mexico, where a lot of them have their roots.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, and so another part of what I'm hearing you say is that there's this cultural aspect. I mean, besides like specific content that you're using to enhance and enrich your curriculum, that there was this cultural experience that you had that is helping you to connect in a deeper way with the community that you're serving. So this is a question for, you know, for the whole panel. How can differences in culture and cultural experience contribute to a global educational experience?
Well, first of all, I think just having a lot of different cultural perspectives opens up the mind of a student to different other perspectives and also different biases that are in the media. So part of the CAPSIN process was obviously to research about the issue. And so I think the application of actually recognizing perspectives and recognizing media bias is really important when you develop your own perspective and own experiences. And recognizing those perspectives is really important to understand the full conflict and how to find an actual solution to the conflict.
I think it's critical to have these types of, I was just reflecting actually on Carrie, the fact that you said your students respect you more, but I think that you are showing them respect because you're learning their language and showing this interest in their culture. And I think it's really critical to do that and leverage that diversity in your classrooms as much as you can, because it more deeply engages students, helps them to see that they're respected as well. And then just having other students really realize that this is important, that they have this empathy and respect for people from different cultures that they're going to be working with and living with in the future is critical. And when we think about business especially, you know, this is something that they want. They want to go to any company's webpage and they pretty much have a page on diversity, and they're trying to recruit more people from diverse backgrounds because they see the value in that perspective. There are studies that show that diverse teams are more innovative because you don't have that groupthink, but they're also more quick to innovate because they don't have that groupthink. And in the future, where you know the economy is really going to have all of these jobs that are based on innovation, that's going to be a really critical skill. So we need to develop that within the classroom.
I think from the classroom perspective, it's just more engaging for the students. Something I've been starting to do this year is like I have a big box on my board where I write down why should you care about this unit, because I know a lot of kids don't care about history, and that's okay and that's fine, but like I try and connect it to how they will care about their lives. And something that's always up there is that, you know, you should care about the world and other people, and I've tried to connect my students with kids in other countries. And so I was a Peace Corps volunteer before this. this, so I have a lot of connections through that, and there's this Worldwide Schools program, so I've connected my students with kids in Rwanda and Moldova and Ukraine and Timor-Leste, about to do one with Saudi Arabia, and then through Koldyke, we connected with Generation Global, which is a UK program. They coordinate and facilitate dialogues between schools in different countries, so I'm in the process of setting it up, and on June 6th, my class will be like having a Skype conversation with kids in Colombia. And so doing these things gets my kids interested. It gets them caring about what's going on. It gets them caring about what's going on in the world. It gets them caring about what's going on in the classroom. They tell me, I ditched every class, but I'm coming to yours. You know, and that's nice, but it's not just because they like me. It's because the content and some of the things that I'm teaching, and I'm not just teaching history like it's a bunch of named dates and places, or it's not just a bunch of old white men from the past, right? It's like things that they can connect with, and people that look like them, and people that have similar experiences to them, or that are totally different, so that they can learn about some of these other things.
What are some other best practices, either Cindy, that you've experienced in the classroom, or Heather, that you've seen out there, where there is this engagement that's happening because teachers are leveraging the diversity in their classroom and also, you know, implementing this more globally focused curriculum?
I think one of the best parts of Naperville Central is that we have a very diverse student population. So a lot of our teachers are focused on using that diversity to create conversations. So one of my classes was very conversation-based. So in my peace and conflict studies class, we talked about how we all had different perspectives, and we created peace circles where a student has a topic that they wanted to talk about, and we would spend the entire period discussing it in a circle because we all have different perspectives. So implementing that through conversations and discussions in the classroom is really important.
Thank you.
Yeah, so I'm thinking about, I do a lot of work in career and technical education or vocational education. And so, you know, we always say to start small, start with one project and then build from there. And so there was a teacher in upstate New York who, as a first year ag teacher, knew she wanted to do something global, but she didn't have the capacity to overhaul the whole curriculum her first year. So she had students look at, she was doing food sourcing, and so she had them look at a cheeseburger, and they had to think about where each part of that cheeseburger came from in the middle of winter in upstate New York. And so this really got students thinking about food sustainability, and so they started a campaign then on their own at the local farmers market to get people to buy more sustainable food. And then the next year, they were raising trout for another one of her ag classes, and so she went online and she found a class in Ireland that was also raising trout. And so they had this conversation via Skype where they were comparing the different methods that they were using. And this grew into a trip to Ireland the next year, and now every year she takes a class abroad. At the beginning of the year, they have to figure out what sustainability issue they're going to look at in what country. They have to come up with a business plan. They have to go in front of the Board of Education and get sign-off to do it. They have to do the fundraising. Some are horticulture students as well, so they're growing flowers and selling them to local brides for weddings to make money. So it grew into this larger project, but her students across the board are graduating, are more engaged in their studies because of it.
I just think as a teacher it matters what you like and what you care about, but it matters more what the students are interested and want to learn about. And so the first year when I came to Farragut, I couldn't redo the curriculum. You're a new guy, you're just doing what everyone else is kind of doing. And the kids weren't that interested in it. And so I gave them a bunch of surveys, and I would talk to them all the time, and what are things that you like? What are things you're interested in? So I changed the entire curriculum to be more about like a thematic approach to the world. So my units are things like globalization and immigration, extremism, war and genocide, revolution and social justice, because those are things that they wanted to learn about. And there's also so many more ways that you could connect that to their lives. There's so many more resources for things like that. And you can teach all the common core skills that my principal wants us to teach too. So,
so we're talking about these amazing projects. What can we do to improve globally focused education in Illinois and beyond?
I think one thing we should improve on is the rigor of coursework. So as I said, for the Global Scholar Program, we have we require 8 credits of globally focused education, which is obviously extremely important. But for schools that have the resources to have those globally focused classes and also fund the Global Scholar Program, where students are doing their own capstone and implementing their own actions, it's more devoted towards schools that are in regularly high income areas. So making ensuring that low income areas can also have globally focused education and also have the resources to complete a capstone course or to actually make an impact on their community.
Yeah, and I think you'll see a lot more global education happening across the state as a result of the Global Scholars Program. In Wisconsin, where they had the first program, it's now spread across the state, and 80 different districts are offering it. And a lot of rural districts actually are offering it because they see this as a way to compete with the urban districts who may not offer this. It's something unique for them to have. But even if you don't have a state program, I think doing high-quality project-based learning is really important, because my son had to do a diorama last year, and I was like, oh, diorama is not a high-quality project, you know? So we have a framework that we use at Asia Society called SAGE. So the S stands for student choice. So we want students to have that voice and choice in their projects, whether that's choosing to focus on their own heritage, if they're interested in it or not. The A is for authenticity. So it should be real-world work, something that you would actually do in the real world. The G is for the global perspective. Add in that global question. Have them compare or learn from another country. And then E is for exhibition to a real-world audience. When students have to present what they're doing to somebody who is in business or parents or anybody from outside the classroom, they take it that much more seriously, and they do, you know, higher quality work than they would otherwise. So putting in some of these frameworks and improving some of the project-based learning, too, I think is really helpful. It's a need across the country in many places.
There's so many great programs out there, and we just don't know about them. I've never heard about either of these programs, and I read every single email I get, you know? Yeah. So I would love to offer my students that type of opportunity, you know, but I just didn't know about it. And maybe that's spreading some of these things through, like, Chicago Public Schools and the people who are in charge, so that they can kind of filter it down through everybody else. But yeah, I mean, I'm going to get that information from you and try and get my students to apply next year. So it's knowledge. It's just, you know, spreading the word, I guess, is a big factor.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, and there are a lot of free resources out there for professional development, for lesson plans. We offer a lot on our website, including online professional development resources that are low cost or free, including one on respecting diversity and how you bring those conversations into your classroom. But there are a ton of organizations out there that have a lot of online resources for free.
What would be some of them off the top of your head? Like, if we're talking about tools and resources for teachers and for schools and for school systems, what would be some of what you consider to be best practice?
Yeah, so obviously our website has just a ton. You can go on and search. You mentioned the Peace Corps Worldwide Schools has some curriculum as well. Global Oneness Project is great. They do high quality film on different global topics, and then they have a lot of free curriculum online that you can filter by your grade and the class that you're teaching. So that's another good one for very specific content. World Savvy is up in Minnesota. They offer a lot of professional development as well. The Teach SDGs for the UN Sustainable Development Goals has a lot of free lesson plans as well. So those are a few.
Locally, if anybody, Facing History is incredible. Yeah. They're in Chicago, they have an office, and they have just amazing resources, full curriculum, professional development training, and for CPS teachers, they're usually free or $10 or something like that, so.
And with any of these resources, are there networks that teachers and students can tap into so that there's, you know, not only what you can access online, but some potential thought partnership?
We're launching a new platform called Global Explorer, and so that is, I think we're launching it right now, I should know, but it's about to come out. And so that will be an online network of teachers who are interested in teaching globally. And then I have another set of online modules called Career Readiness in a Global Economy, and there are online conversations that go on around those, the discussion boards, and they're quite active, actually, so that's another place to find other teachers who are doing this kind of work.
And I know with the Cold Light Global Teachers, we're also trying to create a network of teachers so that teachers who have had this experience, you know, are more globally focused, can also meet with one another, get to know with one another. So over the years, you know, we're building a real significant pool of teachers that can also be a network and a support to one another. So we're getting to the time now where we're going to have some questions from our audience. She's here. Thank you, Rachel.
No, thank you. So we do have time for questions. Please wait for the microphone if you have a question in the room. And please do go ahead, if you're online, to submit your question to chicnf.io. But we can take some questions now. Or actually, I can get started. We've got a question already that is really about the role of parents. So what role do parents play in global education and sort of the outlook of their children? And are parents open to the models that you discussed or employ in your classroom? Maybe Heather, you mentioned that you're a parent yourself, so maybe you can take that one.
I think parents are really important to support this as well. We were talking about networks. I also run this international network of schools, and we have five cities that come together each year around best practices in education. And so we were in Australia in March, and we were talking about future-ready schools, leaders, and systems, and what does that look like. And we were talking actually a lot about assessment and how do we assess these skills, because we need different types of assessment. It can't just be standardized assessment. I think there's a lot of work going on in that area right now, but the Asian systems were mentioning that they had actually been trying to step back on the high stakes testing. China, I think, just got rid of the one that you take at the end of middle school, so they still have the one at the end of high school. But their big problem is parents. Like, parents want these tests because they want to rank their students and see how they're doing. So I think it's interesting, the role of parents, because they can have a lot of influence over what happens in the school, whether it's in your classroom or more broadly. So getting parents to understand the importance of these skills, I think, is really important, and getting them to be people who go out and speak to the importance of it to other stakeholders, whether it's administrators or state policymakers, is important.
And I think going off of that, so parents are really the largest influencers of a student's life. So I think starting that global education young and making sure that the children understand that there are different perspectives around the world and there are different cultures around the world can also really help for high school courses and middle school courses as well.
Mm-hmm. Great. Questions from our audience. Yes, right here in the middle.
Hello, thank you all so much for your time and being here today. I have a question concerning institutional barriers to funding for schools that are in marginalized neighborhoods. Cindy, you had brought that up as a major issue, and realistically it is for so much of America. And so what are some solutions on the ground that you've seen that have worked around the world, things that we can maybe use here to try to reallocate funding from places that have an abundance within the institutional framework of a city, you know, a municipality, et cetera?
Thanks.
Yeah, it's a great question. We were actually talking a little bit about that before we came out, because I was saying that at Chicago Public Schools, one of our strategies around global education is the IB program. But the IB program is expensive. And even though we're very strategic about where we're putting it on the south side, we're putting it on the west side, when you think about rolling that out to over 650 schools, may not have the resources to do that, right? So Heather actually had some really interesting thoughts about that.
Well, I was just saying when we were talking before that teachers can be interested in doing this on their own, so there are a lot of the free resources and professional development out there to help them. But of course, then they have to go out and find it on their own. So I think having more support from administrators around professional development for these different types of programs is important. And there was a Herrick School District on Long Island. There was a superintendent there for a long time, found this to be a priority. And he said, it's not about the money, it's where you place those priorities and how you use the money you have. So he made sure that they had professional development opportunities that were focused on global. That was just a part of the PD budget that they have. I mean, in this country, we obviously need to think more critically about how we do our funding in general, because when you go up to Canada, Toronto is a member of the network that I run, and they're very focused on equity, and they allocate money based on where the need is. It's not a per pupil. It's, you know, this school has a much higher need, and therefore they get much more money, which is not something we do here. So that's sort of a larger systematic question that we need to address. But I think for teachers who want to teach in this way, there are a lot of resources that are out there, and they can also, I think, do more to push for the better high-quality professional learning opportunities within their schools and systems, because it's still a lot of one-off kind of thing. So,
mm-hmm. Great. Luis in the back.
Great panel, great topic, thank you. To Cindy, what do you think is the role of world languages in acquiring something like what you have just accomplished, and what would be your suggestion as we're working on trying to get more high school students to take world languages for a longer period of time, not just concentrating on those 2 years? We know that taking a world language for only 2 years is not going to get the kid too far within that. So if you can just talk to the language side of things.
So Heather actually talked about this when we were in the green room, but one of our main points is that languages do really help with global perspectives. It obviously opens up the mind of a student, and because languages also incorporate that cultural aspect into learning. So while world language are really, really helpful in understanding the world perspective, I don't necessarily think it is extremely necessary, but it will obviously help. Obviously, like the language focused on culture is very important to understand the perspectives of other cultures. But I think for to require languages for more than 2 years has to start with the policy side and having parents understand that languages are important. So obviously, for the high school and high income areas, a lot of them are focused on having 4 years of math, 4 years of science, going into STEM fields, because that's what is considered important in the economy and societal expectations. So having parents understand that languages are important to actually communicate in the real world is also important.
Can I quickly jump back to her question real quick?
Yes.
So I 100% agree with you, and it's super frustrating. Every year we get our budget at our school, and I'm in Little Village. We lose hundreds of thousands to millions every single year, except for last year. But mostly we're losing big amounts of money. And it's frustrating. I'm like, why don't we have some of the same things that they have in other schools and suburban schools? And in the process of one of the things that I told you all about earlier, whenever I connect with a school in another country, my students make videos and from our school, and we send it to the kids in that school, and they make a video and they send it back. And I had a friend who was teaching in Saudi Arabia, and he got my video, and he was just like, I can't do it. I can't make a video because the kids will be so embarrassed, because you have all this stuff. You have a library, you have the smart board, you have the Chromebooks, you have all these things. So like, could it be better? Yeah, absolutely. But I think we also got to appreciate the things that we have globally too. And like from a teacher's perspective, there's so many resources that we can have to make our classes better. And from our students, technology can kind of even the playing field a little bit more, you know. Most of our classes have Chromebooks in the classroom, you know, and could it be better? Absolutely. I wish it was better, you know, but we do have some positive things that I think we need to, like, be proud of, too.
Other questions? Yep, right here.
On the theme of technology, I think we all realize that travel and authentic travel experiences are kind of hard to come by for lots of people or out of reach for financial reasons. And I wonder if technology is playing a role in your classroom or in I have a personal attachment to this for virtual exchange. Just the ability to cross cultures in a very low cost way in real time and have some authentic cross cultural experiences that way.
Yeah, Carrie, I know you mentioned global classroom or the generation global work. And I think Cindy, your class also worked with them.
Yes,
right?
We do.
Are there other ways that you've been working with classrooms outside of that institution, or maybe describe a little bit about the session that you had with them?
Yeah, so we had actually two sessions with Generation Global. The first one was with a classroom in the UK, and I think the topic was about extremism and what we could do to stop it within our own community. And then our second session was with a classroom in Ukraine, where we talked about community building. So obviously technology is very important to have that cross-cultural communication, and I think it's really important to have that in classrooms, because the Skype time that you can have and the actual direct conversations that you can have with the efficiency of it is extremely important and really efficient overall. So with the two sessions, both of them were really eye-opening, because you see students who obviously don't speak English very well in Ukraine, but we were still able to have that conversation about community building and what we could do with our community, and then talk about our schools and what we like about our schools, what we can improve about our schools. And with the session with the classroom in UK, obviously we were both English speakers, but having that different perspective. So with the UK students, a lot of them asked us, oh, do you think all Muslims are extremists? And obviously the answer is no. But the persona that a lot of American students put on is that we do think that. And so having that technology to cross that barrier and not have the media bias and have direct communication is really important.
Great. I think it can be such a simple but powerful experience. So as another parent on the panel, mm-hmm. when my oldest daughter was in third grade, I met a woman through the council who was from Tunisia. And she had a niece who was also in third grade. So we decided to set up, and I'm at a neighborhood Chicago public school, and this is some basic technology that the school has. And they don't have a lot of fancy stuff, but they had Skype technology. And we did a Skype between Tunisia and a Chicago public school classroom, her niece, my daughter. And they did a little bit of work of understanding where Tunisia is in Africa. And I think a lot of the kids had a preconception of what those kids were going to look like. The Chicago public school classroom that my daughter's in is every color. I mean, black, brown, white. And so was the Tunisian classroom. They were like identical mirrors. And I think that was one of the biggest surprises, was just how similar all of the kids looked in each of the classrooms. And then there were other really interesting things, like the Tunisian teacher was really surprised about how informal the class was, how the kids are sort of sitting in groups. And there's just more of a free form. There's more creativity. Whereas the classroom in Tunisia was very desks, kids in front of desks. Everything was very scripted. So the teachers afterwards had some conversation about that. And so that was so simple, right? But it led to some really big aha moments, both for the kids, but also for the adults.
Great. Yep, in the back. Thanks.
Thank you. Hi, thank you. So I went to international school in Bahrain next to Saudi, and then I had IB and American program because it's international school for my early childhood education. Then I came to America and went to public school. And now I'm studying cybersecurity for master's. And I noticed how my early childhood education has benefited me, because in my school, everybody from different countries, Switzerland, and Japan, everywhere, Saudi Arabia. And I was talking to Lemmy Ola, who does the Critical Thinking Child program in Chicago, and it's about raising critical thinking skills. And she's also involved in cybersecurity and trying to fill that skills gap that many Americans have to enter the cybersecurity field. And we need more children to be prepared in critical thinking skills if we're going to compete at a global level and fill that shortage. And obviously, as the other, you know, as other people have said, there's many disadvantaged children in Chicago, including foster kids who may not even have a stable home to go to. And so when you're worried about violence and things like that, I mean, I don't know how you can focus on studying. And the next industrial revolution, it seems like what Lemmy Ola told me is that many of the jobs that are going to be taken away, they do not involve critical thinking skills. So any idea, like, how could that be I know, like, being able to think from other cultures is great because that improves critical thinking skills, because that's helped me in my studies. But is there any other ideas for helping out, like, disadvantaged children, foster children, children in very violent areas, so that they're prepared for the STEM skills gap and prepared for critical thinking? Yeah.
Yeah.
Thank you.
Maybe Abigail, you could talk about that from the district perspective, some of the skills gaps that might be present currently, but, you know, in 30 or 40 years when the workplace really changes dramatically, how a district like yours is thinking about that.
Yeah, I mean, that's a whole other program.
Yes, indeed.
But I think in short, you know, in Chicago Public Schools, we've been talking a lot about what does it mean to be trauma-informed, and what does it mean to be trauma-sensitive? Because that's what you're talking about. How are we and can we be educating children who every day are coming with trauma? How can you learn when you are coming from an abusive environment or there's, you know, food insecurity in your home and in your community? And so we try to think about that for our schools. You know, we've got breakfast, lunch, snack, you know, at all of our schools across Chicago Public Schools. Even during the summer, we'll have our schools open so that there are hot meals, because we know that that kind of sustenance is so important. We've partnered with Lurie's Children's to do the trauma training, and we've been having conversations, you know, with others that are experts in that field, so that that can be something that we sort of raise the expertise across our counselors and our social workers, but also our administrators and our teachers. So that's something that's going to continue to become a more robust part of what we're doing. And then we also know the really important part, you alluded to it, is around early childhood. You know, it's like really having these very rich environments in early childhood so that they're not falling behind, so that, you know, you don't have an eighth grader graduating, you know, at a fourth grade reading level and going to high school and needing to be successful, you know, in high school and get through high school to graduate. You've probably heard just about like our former mayor's initiative around universal pre-K, so that there can be pre-K for every child across Chicago, because we know how important that is. But I think, you know, just in terms of some of the conversation that we've had on the panel, like problem-based learning, and there being more of a project base versus worksheets and other kinds of more one-dimensional ways of learning, is really a way to cultivate, you know, at every grade level, the kinds of critical thinking skills that you're talking about.
Yeah, so thank you. Maybe that's a little primer for one of our next panels. I really would be remiss if I didn't have the chance to thank our outgoing Cold Lake Global teachers. We have a couple in the room. So Anne Michelle from Whitney Young, thank you so much. And Joanna Fernandez, thank you so much for the work that you're doing at your institutions. It's really been fun to work with you and Carrie and the other Annalisa and Heather who can't be here. I'd also like to introduce the 2019 Cold Lake Global teachers. So when I say your name, please stand. We've got Emily Brown from Mansueto High School. Thank you. Welcome. We've got Brian McDowell from Chicago High School Agricultural Science. Dinah Dean from De La Salle Institute. Welcome. Andrea Anders from Chicago Vocational Career Academy, and Alicia Gonzalez from Walter Payton College Prep. Thank you. So I'm really excited to get to know you and to work with you over the course of this year. You folks will be on a journey with the council that really can include everyone here. If you'd like to know more about the Cold Lake program, more about this community of practice, interested in global education, want to bring students or yourselves to programs, please email me, and I think my email is up on the screen. So thank you to Mike Coldike and Pat Coldike. Thank you to Evo for joining us tonight. And I just hope that you all will join me in thanking our panelists, Heather, Cindy, Carrie, and moderated by Abigail. Thank you so much.